All team, give it everything you got.
It's time to fangirl flail with Fangirls Going Rogue.
Count me in.
I don't think there's anything more important in the Star Wars universe than the fans.
News, discussion, and commentary from the female point of view.
You call this a diplomatic solution?
No, I call it aggressive negotiations.
With your hosts, Teresa Delgado, Tricia Barr, and Sarah Woloski.
Boy, am I glad to hear your voice.
Strap in, because this is where the fun begins.
I like the sound of that.
Hey, yo, Cubs, and welcome to episode 65 of Fangirls Going Rogue. My name is Teresa Delgado, and I am back, and I am so happy to be so. And thank you to Sarah and Tricia for manning the fort last month for me. Sarah, you did a great job, by the way.
Oh.
Great job.
Well, thank you very much. We were debating, Tricia and I, who should do the pre-roll? Who should do the intro?
I know. You, what was funny is I got to listen to that episode as just a listener, and I was just sitting there going, they're so good. They're so good.
Aw.
So I was so happy. So thank you guys for doing that for me. So Sarah, how is your new year?
Oh, excellent. I'm very glad it's not 2018 anymore. It was a bit of a crazy year, so definitely looking forward to the new year, and we're 6 days in right now as of when we record, and things are looking up.
And Tricia, how are you?
I'm a little frantic, but that's the perils of podcasting and microphones that decide not to work.
Yeah, that happens a lot. Or Skype doesn't play. Cats make all kinds of noise.
Well, you know, Skype has a panic button. Like if you're in a panic mode or it's a really important call, then, you know, like the biggest interview of your life, it won't work.
I know. It does it on purpose. It does. But we have a special guest with us today, Kai from She's Yogi Kai on Twitter. What's going on?
Hello, ladies. Happy New Year. Everything's good. I'm in Christmas withdrawals.
You're in Christmas withdrawals.
Yes, because I had an amazing Christmas and I bought myself all the things and now it's over.
Congratulations. Aww. I feel you because we just put away Christmas in our house today. And always my most hated part of Christmas is putting away all the Christmas decorations. And now my poor little family of porgs that were happily nestled under the tree now have no place to nestle.
They're homeless.
Yes.
Homeless porgs.
They're sitting on my bare floor.
All right. Well, you know, it is 2019, and 2019 very well could be the year of Star Wars. There is so much happening for Star Wars. So, Sarah, remember when you were saying, oh, this feels nice. There's no pressure. Well, guess what? 2019 said, suck on this. Literally. Oh, my gosh. So what are you guys excited for? Tricia, you go first.
I think the obvious one is what we've gotten a little bit of news about this week with the Barron's articles on Galaxy's Edge. So the park in Disneyland is going to be opening, what, in June? I mean, that's way faster than I thought it would come. So it's kind of freaky because I remember distinctly the idea of Galaxy's Edge, but now it's kind of going to be real.
Yeah, and I have to piggyback off of that. I am definitely excited for Galaxy's Edge. I'm excited and I have a little bit of trepidation just because, the estimates of the people who are going to be at Disneyland trying to get into that park, I don't know. It's going to be crazy, but we have a plan. We're going to go and like ride a ride every time and then, you know, spend 6 hours in line and then go back home. And then go back again and ride a separate thing. So, well, we'll see. We'll see how it works. But the second thing I'm really excited for is Captain Marvel, which comes out March 8th. And I'm so excited because it's birthday movie.
Yay, birthday movie.
Speaking of birthdays, though, Tricia, is there something else you're anticipating this year?
It's a monumental event, but I am into the 1 month until my 50th birthday. So I will have lived half a century on February 2nd.
Awesome. And Tricia, it changes nothing. I was there last year and it's just as good as it was the 20 years before.
Well, I remember turning 30 and like panicking about it. And then I turned 40 and I was like, this isn't so bad. So I think 50 will be exciting.
When you were a child, did the actual milkman come to your house?
Sassy lady, no. The milk, that was my father, and he had an Iceman too, but no.
I remember back seats without seat belts.
Oh yeah, all the time.
My entire childhood never wearing a seatbelt.
And bike helmets? What's that? Oh my gosh. The things we did. I'm amazed I made it to 50, but hey, what the heck? So Teresa, what are you excited for?
Well, I am excited for two books. Queen Shadow by E.K. Johnston, which is the Padme book, and Master and Apprentice by Claudia Gray. I'm so pumped for these two books, and it's just like, just give them to me now so I can read them.
They're the prequel trilogy books we always knew we wanted.
Yeah. So I'm really pumped about new books, honestly. That's because Galaxy's Edge gives me a lot of anxiety. And because of all of the people and all the things, but the way it's looking, Disneyland is trying to clear everyone out by just raising prices 500 million percentage points. Also, when we all were talking about Galaxy's Edge, it made me think about, I came home today and Greg tells me, hey, did you know that how you do in the Millennium Falcon ride is going to follow you around for your entire experience? And I was like, yeah, totally. And I'm like, I'm going to bomb it so I can be a bounty hunter.
You want a wanted poster with your face on it, right?
Yes, I do. I do.
All right, Kaisa, what are you looking forward to?
I'm excited for like everything that comes leading up to episode 9. Like, I think back when I was a kid and just the first time I read in Starlog magazine that George Lucas had 9 films planned, and it blew my mind. Like, I just couldn't, you know, and then we went through the dark times where we thought there would never be another Star Wars film. And now I'm just here for every step. First trailer, celebration, fan debate, but hopefully very nice fan debate, that lineingup.net, seeing you and Richard. And I just really putting out energy, like somehow, some way, I would love to go to the premiere because I've been so blessed to go to the first two. I'll do anything. And I just feel like it would be a perfect kind of way to end it. Like, I never imagined, if you told my 10-year-old self that there would really be 9 movies and I'd actually go to a premiere, I'd be like, I'd pass out on the street. Mm-hmm. So I'm just excited to every step towards 9 and being very positive as much as I can. And also being open to knowing that there's new creators, it's new times. I just want to find that 10-year-old kid who didn't judge anything and just took it in.
And, you know, since we're talking about things we're excited about for the new year and stuff, a lot of times what comes along with that are New Year's resolutions. And I know some of you may have made New Year's resolutions for yourself or just goals for yourself for this year. But one of the ones that a lot of people make is usually centered around health and fitness. And what's really cool is that Star Wars has sort of jumped on that, and they have an initiative called Fuel Your Force. And this encourages us all to use Star Wars to improve our inner selves. And I know that Tricia, on the last show, you had kind of talked about, you know, turning 50 and being the healthiest version of you. So I thought we would kind of turn that into a little bit of discussion. But first, let's play a little bit of this video that is on YouTube. You can find it on StarWars.com/FuelYourForce about what the initiative is.
Listen to the heart that beats inside you, to the flow of your breath. Feel the energy that connects you to everything, to all of us. Focus on the journey ahead, your pathway. fueled by the Force. What fuels your Force?
Okay, so, Tricia, how are you fueling your own Force, ma'am?
Well, turning 50 will fuel your Force. And just that you're like, okay, where am I? What am I? What am I going to be? Am I going to be, I don't know, just your body when you get older, it doesn't want to burn food as fast and you feel slower. And so I started last year with a goal and I've been taking Pure Bar classes, which is a type of bar workout, kind of a Pilates mixed with yoga, mixed with ballet. And I'm going to hit 250 classes at sometime in my birthday month next month, but that's a lot of 2-minute planks, let me tell you.
Congratulations.
But when I do those things, I almost always wear a Star Wars shirt or my Ahsoka workout outfit, or Wonder Woman is also a favorite from her universe. So thank you for all those cool different superhero things, because I can look at it and go, Ray wouldn't give up. Ray wouldn't give up. As I'm staring at myself in the mirror. So, you know, this Fuel Your Force thing was really weird too, because there was a tweet from Star Wars in like the middle of the holidays, but with like no backup, it just kind of showed up. And I think it was like an automated tweet. And then, you know, there's this initiative. So it's really cool because you're setting your goals and you're like, but there was no fanfare about this. I don't even know how many people know about this going on.
Oh yeah. Your show notes were like the first thing I had heard about it.
Yeah. You know, and I came across it by accident actually. And I said, oh, that's cool. And I just thought it fits so perfect with some of the things that we've been talking about. And Sarah, you actually started, when was this? Was it a year ago?
Yeah, I believe it was. Oh, gosh, I can't. You know, it was like April last year or something where I was feeling kind of, it's hard. If you do exercise 30 minutes a day, it's pretty easy to keep that trend going. But when you have been out of it for a while, it's really hard to just start, to motivate starting yourself. And it's really like those first 10 minutes that like are the hardest. So what I wanted to do is start kind of an accountability group on Facebook or something that would help me like check in every day and like, oh, I did my 30 minutes of exercise kind of a thing, because the Apple Watch is just not enough. So I kind of put that out to our Facebook group, our Skywalking Facebook group, and asked, hey, does anybody know of any kind of accountability group? And they're like, no, but let's start one. So I was like, oh, okay. So we kind of all started this Hoojib Hoppin' Fitness Club. It's a closed group on Facebook, which you can request to join. And it's basically a group where we all help each other and cheer each other on. We're cheerleaders for each other. So it's small, but it's fun because it's good to have an accountability somewhere.
Yeah, and that's a great group I'm a member. And what I like about it is how it seems like it goes in cycles. And if one of us becomes active, we all become active. Like we inspire each other.
Indeed. Yes, definitely. What about you, Kai?
For me, consistency is the key. I just have like genetic fundamental good health. For me, I think it's not that I don't want to create a health thing, but in a way it's a challenge that I don't have a condition. So consistency is the key for me. And I love yoga because I've been working with a lot of seniors lately. And weight is important, but the most important thing is mobility. And you want to have strength so you don't fall. You want to walk. You want to be able to move because we're all living longer. And so I just need consistency. So I love doing yoga with Adrienne. It's a Facebook. It's actually YouTube. And YouTube has so many free exercise things. Honestly, you type in yoga and you will get like probably a million videos. Wow. And it's all free. And I like yoga with Adrienne because she does it. Her dog is in every video and he just lays there while she does yoga. And also it's for all levels and it's in my phone. So if I'm at work and I have an hour between clients, I'll go in the back and do yoga. It's on my TV. So I really have no excuse not to do yoga every day.
Yeah, well, that's really awesome. So one of the things that I want to do is actually start getting into yoga. And I haven't done it purely because I'm almost in a weird way intimidated by it. I don't even know where to begin. So you and I are going to have a talk.
Yes.
About where
to start.
Mm-hmm. About where to start with doing what I want to call Yoda yoga. I really want to do that. But overall, I have... like, I want to get rid of, I feel like I'm on an infomercial, that stubborn belly fat that I started to get when I like turned 30. And I'm like, what is this business? And where did that butt come from? So all of that to be said, I do want to start working out, and I'm terrible at it. Like, the rest of you are great at it. And Sarah, you always do workouts and it shows up on my watch and I'm like, rub it in my face. You know. And because, I mean, how often, Sarah, do you get a notification from me? Not very. And when you do, you're usually like, wow, good job. Uh-huh. So that's one of the things I want to do. But also, I think one of the things that's really important for me is healthy eating and trying to reduce the amount of sugar that I'm taking in, because sugar is my personal devil. And so I'm truly trying to do that, and home cooked meals and all of that stuff. And actually, StarWars.com has some recipes that are a part of this Fuel Your Force. And one of the ones that I really like is the lightsaber. What is it? It's lightsaber fruit. And so they basically took their fruit sabers. They took like kebab sticks and put a bunch of grapes on them, or raspberries and strawberries, to make lightsabers. And then there's like a fruit dip or whatever. And so they show you how to make it. But one of the good things about my wanting to eat healthy is actually my husband got a whole bunch of new kitchen gadgets.
Kitchen gadgets.
He got an amazing food processor, an ISI whipper like canister. Would you don't just have to make whipped cream. He made carbonated grapes the other day. They were so good.
That looks so good. I saw your picture. I'm like,
You could do that with blueberries and then put them on the stick, and it'd be like Luke's blue lightsaber.
Yes. Yeah, let's do it. But also another reason I want to start working out, and I really, really want to get into this, is because I have so much cute workout clothes. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even know that Fifth Sun released a Star Wars active line, guys. I don't know if you've seen this, but the bunch of the shirts say Feel the Force, or The Force is Strong with this one. The one I like the most, that I feel like we all need, it's a tank top. And Sarah, I know how you feel about tank tops, but still, just humor me. Okay. Just humor me. It says Star Wars: A New Hope Fitness Club 1977.
Oh, that's cool.
It's so cool. But yes, cute workout clothes is also a plus. And I have a bunch of it and I don't use it.
So we all have our motivations now.
Also, there is a company called On It, and they have released some Star Wars workout gear. It's actually pretty cool. They have a Death Star medicine ball. It's a 20-pound like medicine slam ball. They also have a yoga mat that's Han Solo and carbonite.
I've seen that.
Oh my gosh. Okay, that'll get me to do yoga.
And then they have
kiss can if you do plank, Sarah. That's the right.
Oh, there you go.
One push up. Two push-ups.
Yeah, you can match your hands on top of his hands and meet his face if you go down.
Oh my gosh.
Along with physical fitness, as we all know, there are building blocks to building up your body, right? One of them is how you eat. One of them is your overall physical fitness state, strength, endurance, all of that. Also, how much you sleep. All of those things have a huge, strong effect on your overall mental health. And we're actually recording this on a Monday. So Fangirls Going Rogue is going to have a Mental Health Monday, guys.
Yay!
So I hope you're all down. But basically, I really wanted to get into mental health and Star Wars purely because it's extremely passionate for me. But also, we have someone in the Star Wars community that has come out talking about his mental health and the decline of it, and what being a part of Star Wars and the reaction that he got had with him, and how he almost committed suicide. And that is Ahmed Best, who was the amazing Jar Jar Binks. And I say amazing because that character is one of my favorite characters in Star Wars. And I truly, honestly mean that. So we're going to play a few clips here and there throughout this conversation from this video that you can find on YouTube, which we will link in the show notes.
Well, I think before we play anything from Ahmed Best, maybe we should talk a little bit about our experiences with him, meeting him personally, and the things that we know about him. I know, Teresa, you've met him at Star Wars weekends, right?
I did. I had a chance to meet him in 2014, and this is obviously years before I even knew about any of the things that he has come out with recently. And my experience meeting him was one of the best Star Wars weekend experiences I ever had. And I remember in 2014, you kind of really had to choose who you were going to meet, because at one point, Star Wars weekends, you could get in line for one person, get your ticket, and then run to another line and then get another ticket. And they kind of had started to squash all of that in 2014. So you had to be really choosy. And I chose him, and I'm so glad that I did, because he was incredibly kind. He listened to everything that every single person had to say. He gave you a hug, but his hug wasn't like just an, oh, like you're a Star Wars fan hug. It was a genuine thank you for being here kind of hug. And I really feel like the people that he met at Star Wars weekends, now knowing all of this, may have given him, hopefully, some sort of encouragement in his battle with depression to continue to move forward, because we were really, truly, honestly there for him. I actually, so the book I used to take to Star Wars weekends, I would make a page for every character and person I was going to meet. And so I made a whole page and I put like the stats about each character and things like that. And I remember him being kind of blown away by the fact that I had prepared all of this in advance. And so, you know, I just think back on it thinking, man, I hope he knows that was genuine from me, you know, like it wasn't just something I threw together at the last minute or something like that.
Well, anybody else meet Ahmed in as a fan experience?
No.
Well, I actually have an interesting story of not meeting him, and it was because we were too shy, and we should have. So we were at an event at the Arclight Cinema, Arclight Dome, and Richard and I, and we were seeing some movie as a preview, and I can't remember which one, but we noticed that Ahmed Best was there in the audience. And right after the preview, we went to a food place that was right nearby, and he was there too. So Richard was like all nervous, like, gosh, should I go up to meet him? Which is very unlike Richard. And I was like, why are you being very nervous? And he was like, oh, he's one of my huge inspirations for, like, you know, entertainment and the things that we do with our, you know, bodies and characters and things. So he was very nervous to go up to him. So at one point I was like, okay, I'm just going to go up to him and say, hey, can you meet, you know, us? And I was about to do it. And then he like turned away and left. It was like this moment where had I done it like 2 seconds before, I would have been able to talk with him. But unfortunately, because of like timing, it just didn't work out. And so we never got to meet him. So fans, if you see someone that you think you want to talk to, but you're too shy, just suck it up and do it.
Like me and Larry Kasdan.
Exactly. Exactly. So,
or well, me and Elijah Wood.
Mm-hmm. Yes. The reason I bring up Star Wars Weekends is I think I wasn't really aware of how some of these actors were treated until a Star Wars Weekends event that I was at. And it was watching how some people behaved towards Jake Lloyd. And he was signing, and there were people actually saying things like loud enough over towards his booth. Wow. I mean, and I was like, you know, what's happening? Like, but I was like, these people are like emboldened enough to be, they're Star Wars fans, but they're actually like being mean to a person who's a celebrity who's been in the movies. Like, how can this happen? But this was not something that I understood that happened, that people would be capable of treating someone that way. It isn't even something I would even be aware of, that how like Ahmed Best or Jake Lloyd or, I mean, Hayden Christensen has had that problem. We saw it again with some of the actors in the sequel trilogy. And it's the strange, weird kind of way that people mix up people who are playing roles and then how they can treat them. I mean, I wouldn't even say that how they behaved is a way you should treat anybody.
No, no. And it can really affect someone deeply on a personal level, especially Ahmed Best. Now, he recently shared on Instagram a picture of him and his son on the Brooklyn Bridge. And he was explaining that 19 years ago, this was the exact spot where he almost took his life. Now, this post went viral, and Ahmed then shared a YouTube video explaining his entire story. So we'll play a bit of it here, but we highly suggest you guys watch the entire 11-minute video called That Moment I Opened Up About Suicide. Just search YouTube for Ahmed Best Jar Jar, and it will pop right to the top.
And so as you listen to Ahmed talk about how he was treated in Star Wars, it all kind of comes alive.
20 years ago, I played Jar Jar Binks in Star Wars. I faced a media backlash that really made me feel like my life was over. There was just so much hate and venom and anger directed at me. And I took it personally. And a lot of times, you know, I hear people say, we're not talking about you, we're talking about Jar Jar. You're talking about me. I put a lot of me into that work. The hardest part for me in that entire situation was all of the criticism that came from a racially motivated point of view. We're always faced as Black artists with this idea of being a sellout, right? We have our guard up when it comes to being portrayed as an Uncle Tom, a racial stereotype, or anything that makes you as a Black person look less than. It hit me. It came right for me. I was called every racial stereotype you can imagine. There was this like criticism on being this Jamaican broken dialect, which was offensive because I'm of West Indian descent, I'm not Jamaican. It was debilitating. I didn't know how to respond. I was a 26-year-old kid. I didn't have an agent, I didn't have a manager, I didn't have a publicist, I didn't know anything about that. I was just alone. And the depression hit me hard. I was just broken. The only thing I could think of to make me feel better was to walk across the Brooklyn Bridge. But this time when I walked across the bridge, I didn't see the lights of Manhattan. I didn't see the towers. I didn't see the potential of hard work and ingenuity. And I didn't see anything. I just saw a fog. So I walked across the steel girder between the walkway and the bridge. And I was standing at the other edge of the bridge and I was looking down at the East River and I had this thought. I looked out at the East River and I looked out at the Statue of Liberty and I said, well, I had a good life. As I was standing there, a gust of wind just came by and it was really strong and knocked me off balance, right? And I caught myself. That's when I woke up. I caught myself. I thought to myself, if I was really about it, if I really wanted to do this, I would have let that gust of wind just take me. But I didn't.
Star Wars Weekends is one of those times that's incredibly pivotal because I feel like the way that they did it, you got time with these Star Wars celebrities that you don't get at a regular convention. You know, at like regular conventions, it's like you're pumped through almost, you know. Yes. And Chaney and Sophia Hunt actually said that they also got to meet Ahmed in 2014 during Star Wars weekends, saying Jar Jar has always been one of their favorite characters in Star Wars, and meeting him was absolutely amazing. Despite his struggles, he was so kind and gracious to us, and meeting him totally made our day. And it's so interesting because at the time when they would have met him, these girls were so much younger. And I've seen the picture from 2014 when they got a chance to meet him. And I remember being around those girls and they were just so young and in so much awe. And, you know, for someone like Ahmed Best to take the, you know, so much time with them, I think is just absolutely amazing. But kind of talking about some of the things that Ahmed Best said, you know, I can't even begin to imagine. I mean, I'm a minority and I'm a woman, but to be in the place that he was in with the kind of backlash that he got that was so racially tied, and just how much people, I don't know, like things that just people have said and even say to this day, it blows my mind that people would even think that there wasn't somebody that actually played that character.
Well, you can watch the Phantom Menace making of documentary, and they go through great extent on, they were building this character. Like, they didn't even know if he was going to be that, he would play the role with the big head of Jar Jar on him. And they were literally trying to decide how much was going to be Ahmed as like a puppeteer as opposed to CGI. And they were fighting about this. It's in the documentary. It's really a fascinating kind of look at how George Lucas is like, I'm going to do this and I'm going to use computers, and them trying to figure out what are the financials? How can we make the schedule? So, but he is the character. He's standing there interacting with the other actors. He's in the room. He is part of the process. He was very instrumental in creating the character. And he talks about that in the video.
Yeah, it was weird for me. I've never met Ahmed, but I just remember thinking, I've always had a separation of Jar Jar from Ahmed. And so it was fascinating to me because when I sat and saw The Phantom Menace by myself, I was crushingly disappointed. But also, I wasn't raised to talk like that about people. And I dealt with a lot of it internally. But it did make me uncomfortable as a person of color. Like, I just kept feeling like he was reminding me, I'm an old film buff, but he reminded me a lot of when you watch Gone with the Wind, which is a great movie, but you see that the woman who plays her maid, and she's and just watching that. And then when you see her Oscar acceptance speech, you see she was playing a role, but that brought to me, so it was cringeworthy for me sitting there. Because I was just thinking, like, man, there's just this tone deafness, lack of understanding, that to me, I felt like he was saying, every time he was saying Misa, I was hearing master. And mm-hmm. It kind of brought slave culture in my head. But I didn't leave. When I left there, I was crushingly disappointed. And I didn't really talk about it. And I would laugh at Jar Jar jokes. But when I got on the internet years later, it fundamentally floored me that people, to learn that people would say these things about Jake Lloyd and Ahmed Best. Like, it just, the hate and the entitlement thinking that you can spew this, I think a lot of it has to do with the culture of the internet. And I really wonder if we wouldn't have had the sparkings of chat groups and internet in the 90s, if this would have just been a few people never commenting on it. Because I went to cons my whole life, creation cons, and I'd be in line with people, and I never heard people say face-to-face things about Ahmed in the prequels that I hear online. Never in my entire life.
If The Phantom Menace had been released today, I wonder if it would be similar to what Daisy Ridley and Kelly Marie Tran have been treated. to where they have had to literally disappear off of the internet. And I, to me, like, to know that Ahmed Best was so affected even before the age of social media is incredible, because it's not as widespread of a thing. Like, now today, right, if you wanted to insult someone, it's not that hard to get to them, you know?
Well, I think it's important too, because what Kai brought up is talking about the component of being critical of the portrayal of a character, which is a conversation that you can have as a critic or as a fan, and you can have a constructive conversation. You could say, well, that makes me uncomfortable as a receiver of your story, that it, I don't know that you considered how this plays into stereotypes, but we're all going to be affected and have stereotypes. And it's even harder to tell a person of color who has limited chances to get into roles like this, that you know, for him, he talks about in the video, I mean, it was just such a big opportunity. And he, you know, he's a young man, a young creator, so he has to learn these things. But he specifically is being affected not by people talking about the portrayal of the character. He's being affected by people who are coming at him because they hated the Phantom Menace, because it didn't become what they wanted it to be. And they took it out on the characters and the actors in a very personal way. That it's one thing to say, I didn't like something. I'm very honest, I don't like The Last Jedi. It's another thing for me to attack people because I didn't like it, which I'm never going to do. I can have a constructive criticism. I can write a blog post and say, in ways that are very constructive, this is what I didn't like. But it's another thing to escalate. And for Ahmed, it was racially escalated. He was called names. And some of the, I mean, Sophie and Chaney, they were on our podcast and they talked about, you know, they see Jar Jar in a different way than we do. For him, he's a very comfortable character. He's a way that kids can come into the story. And there were adult people, most of them men, most of them white, who did not like what was being presented in the prequel trilogy. It wasn't their expectation. And they became the voice that Ahmed perceived was fandom. Mm-hmm. With no filter. He didn't have the benefit of a Star Wars Weekends where he could meet people like us who said, I enjoyed it, or you brought something positive to my life. As a person who does film criticism, there are things that are wrong with the portrayal if you look at racial stereotypes, but there are also things that he helped make the character, helps make the story accessible. Same thing with Jake Lloyd. There was a reason they chose a young man. It's not Jake Lloyd's fault that people were upset that Anakin was younger than they expected him to be, that they didn't start episode one with Darth Vader fighting Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Right. And you know, the thing when we talk about Jake Lloyd that I find really unfortunate is that at this point, he's an extremely young man and he's a kid. And we come to find out years and years later that, you know, he actually does suffer from a mental health condition, which many of us do. And, you know, I found a statistic today, like 44 million Americans, adult Americans, suffer from mental health conditions. And the fact that here in the United States, it's still such a taboo subject to talk about, you know, and speaking from my own personal culture, a Hispanic culture, talking about mental health, talking about having a problem, admitting to being depressed or having anxiety or many other things that, you know, are possibilities, is something that the Hispanic culture does not like to talk about. Everyone always says, oh, you're fine, you know, like that kind of thing. And it's definitely a major cultural thing. And at least for me, I mean, I can't speak for everybody, but I can speak from what I know. And that for someone like me, who has dealt with mental health conditions for most of my entire life, and it's a very hard thing to kind of deal with, but I was really fortunate enough to have a family that was very open when it came to mental health and accepting that there are
you know, conditions that people have and that, you know, you have to take care of those things. So if you guys don't mind right now, I would kind of like to go pull the curtain back a little bit for some of our listeners to sort of let them know kind of what I've been through. And just so that everybody knows, like, this stuff is real. It exists and it affects us in extremely major ways. And the people that I'm talking to on this podcast right now have had a major impact in my overall mental health, which is part of the reason that I kind of want to talk about it too. So do you guys want to hear the story?
Yes. Thank you for being so brave to share, Teresa.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. So in order to do this, I kind of wrote it down. So it might just help me get through it a little bit easier. For the majority of my life, I've dealt with varying degrees of depression, including low self-esteem and low self-worth. And most of my triggers early on in my younger life were related to my peers, measuring myself against others, comparing myself, and trying to fit in, which I think a lot of us have experienced in our lives. I also had a problem with exceptionally high expectations of myself, even from early on as a really young child. And watching the world around me, I was always determined to, like, be better and do better than my siblings or my cousins or, you know, my parents that had gone before me, and wanting to be, like, the first one that graduated with a degree, you know, and things like that. And by doing that, I felt like if I reached those expectations for myself, then I would make my parents proud, my grandparents proud, my teachers proud. And I was always validated when people, you know, would say that they were proud of me. So at about the age of 13 to 14, the depression had become so much that I was taken into counseling and I started going to counseling. And it was there where I actually started to learn my very first coping skills. And so when I finally became a teacher, teaching coping skills was one of my most important things to do with my students. I still do it today, just because I know how important it is to learn those. I learned the importance of honesty and communication with myself. I also began to learn how to actually forgive myself as well for the times that I couldn't reach my expectations. Now, all of this, while it sounds really good, it was really short-lived, because as soon as I figured out how to do that, high school was over and college came at me. And with that, new stresses of school, relationships, and more extremely high personal expectations, it all came to a head. I had actually seen firsthand when I was I must have been in high school, what attempted suicide looks like, with a very close family member that I actually found that had tried to attempt suicide. So I had seen that, and I knew that I didn't have the strength to do something like that. And for those people who don't know that are listening to this, people who actually attempt suicide, it takes in a tremendous amount of willpower and strength to actually do that. And I know this personally, because I thought about if I would ever commit suicide and how I would do it, and I could never bring myself to fully think out that full process. And so I know that for people that have done that, the just incredible, I don't know, like, willpower and the darkness that they were in order to get there, because I never could. But instead of doing that, I actually became a self-harmer. I began cutting myself at the age of 19, and I am now a self-harm. I have basically permanently called myself a recovering self-harmer. I will probably always be a recovering self-harmer, because that tends to be the first thing I think of when things start to get really tough, is that that's how I'm going to deal with it. So when that happened, I had lost all my coping skills. I had discovered that a physical manifestation of pain would actually help me deal with my emotional pain. And I describe it, or liken it to an addict who is addicted to a drug, that drug temporarily removes the pain so that you don't have to deal with it for that time being. But the longer you do it, the more you need to do it in order to keep the pain away. And it eventually got to a place where it was pretty much out of control. And the only way that I came out of that was actually the threat of losing some very important relationships in my life. And when that happened, similar to Ahmed Best, like gust of wind, that was my gust of wind of saying, okay, you need to get help. And that would have been like around 2004 to 2006. So if you put the Star Wars timeline together with this, that was around the time of Revenge of the Sith. And Star Wars was my saving grace. It might have been Attack of the Clones, but what was going on in that story just captivated me. And then my very first true fan experience was actually the midnight release for Revenge of the Sith. And I met some people there, three specific people. I don't really talk to these three people that much anymore, and I've never told them this, but it was those three people that showed me what fandom could be like, and that their friendship showed me a way to be able to process through pain in a joyful way and through having passion for something and putting the pain that you're feeling into passion for something else. And it was because of that that I truly, honestly became a huge, huge Star Wars fan. So I started to pull back from my self-harm and using coping skills that I'd learned in therapy, and I was back in therapy. And for years, off and on from then, my fandom would be what would help me stay away from self-harm. However, and now this is where you girls come in. In 2011, my life changed extremely dramatically. Podcasting and blogging and Star Wars literally saved my life. I went through some incredibly hard trials in my life that caused me to actually start to self-harm again. I then developed a severe anxiety condition. And really, the only reason I'm here today is because of my friendships that I have with you, my friendships that I have through Star Wars, and because of my faith in Star Wars and some of the incredible characters that I have come to know really close and dear, like Ahsoka, Padme, and there are some others. I was actually given support through the fandom community to finally get on medication for my anxiety, which I had actually fought off for 17 years. And, you know, I can honestly say that being a part of the Star Wars community is what has really helped keep me afloat. And as I've continued to deal with some of those issues, I'm going to call out some people here who may be surprised to hear their names. But anytime I feel like I need to self-harm myself, I actually picture Tricia, Sarah, Kai, you're one of them, the Hunt Girls, Eliza Peralta. If you guys were to see me in the depths of my actual self-harm with, you know, it's hard to say, but like with cuts on my arms or on my legs and what your faces would say and having to explain myself and knowing that I would have caused some severe disappointment with you. And it is that visualization that keeps me away from doing it. So thank you.
Just so you know, we wouldn't be disappointed in you, honey.
Never. It would be, what can we do? What do you need? You know, it's sometimes people, they see in us things that we don't see in ourselves. And I thank you for the gift of sharing this, because you just, I can't tell you how bright you shine, Teresa. You just make everything, all three of you are things that I was looking for my whole life when it came to Star Wars friends. I never had it as a child. And I just think I'm blessed to know you three.
Yeah, Teresa, how old were you when we first started podcast? I'm trying to remember. You were what, in just turning into your 30s when we first met?
We started, when you and I first met, I think it was 2011. So I'm 2014
was Star Wars Weekends.
Yeah, you were late 20s, because I remember we had a conversation, and this is important to go to because what you're talking about is finding community. And I remember having a conversation with you at some point early on in our friendship, as we started doing this, and I had friends who were a little bit older than me through my horse show community. More so, and they had children that were training with my trainer. And I remember them telling me at the time that, you know, when you start to get to about 30, your body does things that are different, and it's okay that you feel like you can't do things. And they were like, it's okay, you can go to your doctor and have a conversation, and you might need some medication. And I had taken antidepressants for about a year or two and done some counseling and was able to get off the medication. But I remember having a conversation with you saying, this feeling that you're feeling isn't, sometimes it's just your body too. I mean, we could talk about all sorts of other pressures as a fan and as a human being, but sometimes your body just needs some help. And this is not something abnormal as you go through life, especially not anxiety. I remember very distinctly, showing the horses, and I would ride anything. And I was about 31 and I was at a horse show and I literally had my first panic attack. Didn't know what it was. Like, I thought I was going to vomit. I felt like my heart was going to beat out of my chest, and the world kind of like went into, I describe it because if you've never had one, you don't know, like everything kind of goes out of your vision and you can only see like maybe straight in front of you. And I'm like, what is happening? Like, why is this happening? Like, I feel like I'm literally, my heart's going to explode. And then I realized that I was in a state of panic, pure panic. And I'm like, why is this happening? Like, I'm fearless. I'm not afraid of anything. I will ride these crazy horses I've never ridden before. That was what I was known for. I would get on anything and jump it. And I realized that I had to go on anxiety medication to get through those things. And it's one of the reasons I think we're attracted to Star Wars stories. They scare you and they terrify you and they take you in different places and they yank on your emotions, but they teach you that you can go through those emotions and come back to a safe state. So like when we talk about the premiere, going to the premiere that Kai mentioned, we go through like a really scary event. It's terrifying to go to premiere because you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know what the story is going to be. You have expectations, and then you come out of it and we're all together. Right.
And yeah. And then Ryan Johnson will come up to you and says, so what do you think?
but then, again, you go through fear, right? In that moment when he says that,
It was like,
so you're like, but it's a way to, but we're doing it together, right? We're having a conversation and doing it together. I remember because after we talked to Ryan Johnson, I think we ended up talking to Dave Filoni for a while. And it was like one of those things like you're, everything's racing. But I think the most important thing, at least to say to everybody who's listening is it is not, it's normal that at some point in your life, your body is going to do things that make you think that you're not normal anymore or that you're not good enough. But that's your body changing, and you have to learn how to understand it and address it. And sometimes you're going to need help from professionals, but a lot of times you can reach out to friends and ask them, you know, I feel really down, or talk to them and they're going to help you. They're going to say, well, you know, maybe you need to talk to somebody, or maybe you need to go see your doctor, or maybe we can just talk about this. I think we've been able to get through things like that. And I think it's really important too, Teresa, you're really brave to talk about it, because there's this filter in social media where we think that everybody's always doing really great in their life. We see all our accomplishments. Hey, I did a book, or hey, I won at a horse show, or hey, we got to go to premiere. And people don't realize maybe all the other chaos, because we're not going to put, well, I had to like figure out if I was going to go to the premiere or if I was going to fix my car, or, all the other impacts that are coming in your life will affect you. Are you worried about it's going to affect your work? Or you're standing in something else, what you're doing. But we don't necessarily share those things. So you look at social media and you look at all your fandom friends, you're like, oh, their lives are so great. They're enjoying everything, but we don't necessarily put all those things up. Right.
Right. And something else I do want to point out is that through being willing to tell my story, and I've told the story to my students, which some people are like, oh my gosh, I'm really honest and really open with them about who I am, because I feel like, especially as teenagers, they really need that. But through doing that and not being afraid to talk about it, I've learned a lot about myself, and I've learned a lot about my own personal strength that I have. And it's actually helped me to be able to cope and deal with all of the things that have happened in my life. And I think because of that, I've been more open. Trisha, I remember the conversation that we've had, and we've had multiple conversations over the years where I have been able to really, truly talk to you about some of the things that are going on. And I think that having someone in my life that has been able to do that for me has been something I gravely needed. And so, you know, I wanted to thank you for that, because you were, you know, before I even knew you, Sarah, I mean, Trisha was already helping me. I mean, this was at a time in my life that it was just crazy. So needless to say, Trisha and I have been through a lot together, and it's been really awesome to have somebody like that. And Trisha, you know, you've gone through quite a bit of stuff recently.
I don't necessarily talk. I mean, people have seen that a few of my animals have died, three this past year, which is really hard. Ganner was the Jedi horse. He was a gift from my grandfather after he died. He was the dream horse, and he had an injury, and I spent a lot of savings. I wrote 2 Star Wars books to pay for his surgery, because I wouldn't have that was my thing. I was like, well, I'm going to give him this chance, but I have to justify it. So I put that extra time in to pay for those surgeries. And I would go out 4 times a day and do his rehab. It was me doing it. And then I would take him to a rehab place when there were times I had to travel, but then I would bring him home, and I spent every day with him 4 times a week. And that was a really painful loss to lose him. And it was very sudden. It wasn't expected, even though he had been retired. And then I had a dog who I happened to get through a Star Wars friend who I knew him when he was a puppy. She read my fan fictions, and she shared him being born. And this was a friend whose husband was going on a second tour, and she was pregnant, and she was a little fearful of the dog. When the husband wasn't there, the dog wasn't as manageable. And we took him into our home just to get while her husband went on deployment, and he never left that dog. So that dog came to me through Star Wars. And then, you know, I had my horse, the older horse that had been older, and it wasn't unexpected for him to go, but it happened so fast after the other two that it's kind of like, oh man, I'm can't really deal with this. But so I still, I kind of want to turn it around, because Star Wars actually affected, when Teresa, when you say you're a recovering cutter, mm-hmm. I will all forever be a recovering anorexic. When I first started riding, I was in high school, and I was 56 pounds.
Whoa.
Yes.
Wow.
Goodness. And I was, one of the things that greatly affected me was the representation of women on screen and how they looked. And when I was in high school, who was the most important character in my life that I've talked about?
Leia.
Princess Leia. Leia. Mm-hmm. And how was she represented in Return of the Jedi?
Oh, in her gold bikini.
And a very thin young woman who achieved that, we all know very well, by doing drugs and not normal means. So that representation of that character really reaffirmed that mentality. And anorexia is not about not eating. It's about trying to control yourself, and it's about societal pressures on you. And so when I talk about objectification of women and how women are portrayed in Star Wars, people don't necessarily understand why I am so passionate about it. I did recover from that. I learned how to manage it, but I, like, I don't stand on a scale ever. That's a bad start for me. So you never get away from those thoughts to want to control what you're doing. The way Leia was represented in that movie really affected me. It was, you know, there's a lot of other really thin women being represented in these kind of unrealistic ideals of women in modeling and stuff like that. So it wasn't just that, but when I talk about it, that's always my passion. It's my, how are you going to represent these women? How is it going to affect the next girl looking at these characters in many different ways? And in dealing with all the other things that have happened last year, not really being thrilled with The Last Jedi, really feeling that it had some poor representation of women and of people of color and the things I've talked about, dealing with everything else and knowing that we really need to fight hard to get the representation up for women in the positions of storytelling. And I have been going to start this project of talking about it, and I could not get myself going on it. And it's an emotional energy that I'm like, should I even try? And that, it all compounds this sadness where I'm like, I'm going to do it today. I mean, Kay, wonderful Kay from Fangirl, has made me this beautiful image to start, to kick off this campaign. And I can't do it. I can't muster up the energy. But I know it's from all the things that have happened in my life and in the ways that I just haven't enjoyed the last couple of years of Star Wars. And I bring this up because I wasn't going to talk about that until I realized when we brought it up in our Facebook group, how many other people mentioned it to you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's a lot.
There were a lot of people who mentioned that. And people say, oh, there's no negativity. Well, you know, most people who don't enjoy something don't do what happened to Ahmed Best. They don't react from a place of, I'm going to verbally say I didn't like it. They just say I didn't like it. But there's such this kind of animosity now that someone says I don't like it, the people who do like it take it personally. Mm-hmm. Like, I struggle with this a lot, especially from other people who talk about inclusion. If I say I don't like something, they take it so personally. Like I'm saying, well, if you like it and you're talking about inclusion, then you must, I think they almost feel like I'm saying, well, you shouldn't like it because of the way it's not perfect in inclusion, but that's not what I'm saying. I like things that I know are problematic. But I just literally don't like the choices I don't like the choices they've made for Han. I don't like the choices they've made for Luke. I don't like the choices they made for Leia. And I think they have some storytelling fails. And I've actually talked to some people in our community who've talked to me quietly about their disappointment in Star Wars. They don't talk about it publicly. But I was surprised with how many people in our community said, Star Wars isn't it for me, but
they're not going to put it out there so generally on social media.
Right.
Because if they do, there's going to be the people that backlash at them, and people don't necessarily want to deal with that. I mean, it's hard to have a open, honest opinion about something and have people respect it.
Right.
And that's kind of the downside of the new canon, is there's so much creative freedom. And we thought we wanted it. And maybe we don't want it as much as we thought we did.
Oh, I never wanted it. But that's a whole other topic.
Yeah, because I fundamentally do not agree with Luke Skywalker. I've made peace with it. But I will, to my grave, I fundamentally disagree with everything in Last Jedi. But there's still things I love about it. And every time I watch it, I get a little bit more. That's also about maturity. Every time I watch it, I don't know if I can see the vision of the people that created it. And I respect that. But I respectfully disagree on a lot of it, too.
Yeah. And, you know, Tricia, you had brought up that a lot of our listeners are, you know, kind of feel the same way. And, you know, if anybody's noticed I'm not incredibly vocal on Twitter, you'll see pictures, but that's because they're coming from Instagram. not because I actually posted on Twitter. Twitter to me has become an extremely toxic environment. And I feel like we are living in a culture that has developed over the past. I mean, I think it's been there since the internet was born, but it has developed very strongly over the past couple of years that it's perfectly okay to hide behind your Twitter handle, your Instagram handle, your internet, whatever, and just spew whatever garbage you feel like spewing,
you know,
it's all over anybody and everyone.
It's not just a Twitter thing. I'll tell you a crazy story about Celebration 3. I had a TFN mod who she was just not a nice person, not a nice person to me ever. I mean, she would just have free reign. And then if you tried to bring up things she said, all, you know, she would just bully all the other mods. I met her at Celebration 3 at a TFN meetup, and she's like, "Oh, Tricia," and she gives me a hug, and she's like my buddy. And I'm like, I'm literally looking at other people who know, like, this is the person, and they know what she's done. I'm like, what is going on? And I'm thinking, maybe she's drunk. Maybe she doesn't realize who I am. Oh, no, she did. It was literally not being face-to-face with somebody that changes how people think they can interact with you. And they will never do those things to your face.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. I know some of the comments.
I will, though.
Well, some of the comments from our Facebook group, I'd like to share a few. Mark Boder said that this last year really tested my fandom. I don't understand how people can invest so much time and energy into something they dislike or hate. I finally decided that I wasn't going to let anyone else's opinion detract from my enjoyment. And I think it's an interesting dichotomy, social media, because social media is a place where we can meet others and we can help each other. I mean, Tricia and Teresa, both your stories, you know, it's about fans helping you, Kai, as well. And it's helping you out of tough situations or mental health. But then there's also the downside to that, where you get so many detractors, you know, that you almost have thoughts of suicide, like Ahmed Best. So it's really this fine line that you really have to deal with. And I mean, Matt Clifton also, he shared something. I've dealt with my own demons all my life and depression over the last couple of years. We used to have our fandoms to escape reality and make us happy. And then after 2016, people got nastier, the sarcasm, snide comments, threats of violence, condescending remarks. I've had to leave groups, drop podcasts. They just don't make me happy anymore. The enthusiasm I used to have just isn't there anymore. So that's very sad that people are feeling this way. But I think what's important is to find your group or your niche or wherever it is that brings you happiness in your fandom. So like for me, it's with you ladies. Every month we get to chat and we reconnect, and it's something, I mean, we have our chat, you know, 24/7, but to be able to talk with you ladies every month, it really fuels my fandom and invigorates me. And just having fangirl friends is very important in my life. And I would be a different person if I didn't have you guys.
Well, it's important too, I think. I mean, I know that a lot of times I'll bring things up to you guys that I'm like, well, this is happening on, you know, Star Wars Twitter, just beware, because I tend to follow more people, and I have friends who keep me informed in some ways as a protection. Like they're like, don't go in this direction. Like, just ignore that. And so, but I've learned over the years too, that you're not obligated to the judicial use of the block button.
Yes.
Which going into communities is helpful, because like for our Fangirls Going Rogue group or the Skywalking group, our mindset is that you're going to be positive, and we very rarely have to moderate these groups, but we do. We make sure that we try to keep people, that their mindset is you can come here, you can have an opinion, but you can't have an opinion where you might be deriding someone else. So you don't, you know, someone saying, oh, the people who don't like The Last Jedi are stupid. No, you can't say that in our group. You can say you don't like The Last Jedi. You can say you love The Last Jedi. You can have a discussion of why you and somebody else fundamentally disagree on how Luke Skywalker came off to you. Because for some people, Luke Skywalker represents rising out of a depression and being redeemed and finding a way. And for other people, they just don't see that they did it effectively in the story. So you can block people on social media, on Twitter. You just say, I'm not going to have a discussion with you. And you can choose to go into groups that kind of curate that the people who come in are not going to be nasty. And if they do, those groups are going to take them out. But I think sometimes especially if you're feeling, I know Teresa and Sarah, we've talked about this and Sandra has too, that when you're not feeling it, sometimes you have to just walk away from those things for a while and find your peace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, Ashley Eckstein was actually talking about that today, about unplugging from your phone and from social media. I mean, she didn't go so far as to say, completely leaving a social media platform for a while or whatever. But I did that in 2012, guys? I think it might have been 2012. I went off of social media for about 6 months where I checked it, but I could only check it on my computer. I took everything off of my phone, and then I gradually added one thing back at a time, but I didn't turn on any notifications. So I still to this day do not have any social media notifications for anything, including down to Messenger. I don't have any notifications because I have chosen to not let the notifications on my phone control my life. So if I make a conscious choice to look at my social media accounts, then I am making that decision for myself, as opposed to what it used to be, which is that it was telling me to look at it. Or at least that's how I viewed it. So, you know, those are things that we all have to decide. I have set up screen time limitations on my phone for different categories of apps, that when the screen time button says you've exceeded your max amount for the day, I have to go, oh, well, boo. No more emoji blitz. Sarah, I know your face right now. You're like, what?
I haven't tried that yet.
Yeah, but I've had to do that because I want to make sure that I am living present in the moments in my life and that I'm not missing those things that are right in front of me. And it stinks because a lot of my friends, Kai, you were saying this, a lot of my friends are not people that I see in person every day. They are on social media or whatever the case may be. So what I've kind of transitioned to, and I posted a picture of this actually on Instagram, is that when my phone says no more social media, I go, oh, okay, I actually have to text people. Sarah, emoji spam.
Nice.
You
that's
know,
cute.
So, but it's transitioned me to having to do something more personal, because even though social media, you could say like that and texting are the same thing, to me, actually texting someone's actual phone number is like so much more personal than sending them like a tweet or an Instagram DM.
It's true. I get like, I'm like, oh, Sarah texted me or Teresa called me the other day. Like, it's like, oh, Teresa's calling. I literally hung up on somebody to answer your call.
But it's cool, right? Because we don't always call each other. And so when we do actually call each other, I'm usually like, oh my gosh, Sarah really needs to tell me something, or Sarah really needs to tell me something, you know, and
or someone just has to get something off their chest.
Yeah. You know, like just a few days ago when my grandmother passed away and Tricia called me, I was like, what happened? Like, does something happen in Star Wars and I don't know? And it wasn't that. She was just calling to see how I was. And it's just like, oh, cool. You know, but it's awesome. Like, I actually loved that phone call. So it's just, it's more personal.
Yeah. You know? I hear you. And you know what? I think we should wrap up our discussion here with a challenge, a Mental Health Monday challenge that her universe actually shared. And I know, Teresa, you had mentioned this a little earlier, but for Mental Health Monday, just today, after we had already decided what to talk about on our show, Ashley Eckstein just posted this Instagram video where she asks us to do two challenges. And so all of our Yubcubbers, we're asking you to do the same. And that is, one, to leave a positive comment somewhere on some social media post of someone you know. Just give them a positive comment, and that will really help spread positivity. And two, to put your phone down for some portion of the day, like whether it be dinner, maybe have dinner present in the moment, or maybe you're going to Starbucks and you want a coffee break and, you know, you take your coffee and you sit at the table and just kind of let yourself be open to the world and things that happen, that, you know, maybe conversations you can get into with strangers or something like that. I know it's scary, but it can happen.
And read more. I read a lot, and that keeps me away from social media.
Oh,
and also, if you have a tablet, like I just got a Kindle Fire, it's very important if you have a tablet that you read on, don't do the other stuff. Don't do email. Don't do notifications. And there's something really comforting about just sitting and reading.
Nice.
But reading, it takes, you know, I find it's funny how a lot of younger people, like, they can't read off their phone. They say they get fidgety. I work on a lot of families, and like sometimes the kids are into sports, so I'll massage the kids. And one day this girl came in and she's like, "Can I play my music?" I said, "Yeah, but you just have to put your phone over there." And she's like, "I can't hold it in my hand." And I was like, "No." And while during the massage, she said to me, can I share something with you? And you won't tell my mom. And I said, "Well, I can't promise you that. If you say something about hurting yourself or hurting others, I'll have to tell your mom." She's like, "No, it's nothing like that. Can you promise not to tell my mom?" And I said, "Yeah." She's like, "I feel really antsy when I'm not near my phone."
Mm-hmm.
And she's 12.
Wow.
And I said, "Well, what do you mean by antsy?" She's like, I feel really nervous. And she's like, "Even if I'm not on my phone," she's like, "I have to have it in my hand." And she said, "Right now I feel really, really uncomfortable with the phone being on the other side of the room." And I said, "Okay." I said, "Well, let me show you some tools to deal with that." I said, "I'm not going to bring your phone to you. We have 34 minutes. You can talk to me. I'll show you some breathing exercises." But she really was having like withdrawals from technology. She could not lay an hour and not have her phone. And so it's really important
to
get away from, and she's 12, and her parents are great parents. And if you have a kid who's 12 and has school and four different sports, of course you're going to give the kid a cell phone. But we have these generations of kids who are having anxiety and stress because of their phones.
And I know, Sarah, you're trying to wrap up, but like, I just have to comment on this because this is so incredibly true. I know what people are talking about, because how did people live in the 1800s when you couldn't know where someone was all the time? You know, they just came home whenever they came home, you know, like now it's, "Oh, I can text you and I get immediate gratification because I know you've read my message because there's a read receipt." But then there's also like so many negatives. There's two sides to everything. It's crazy. Like, as cool as smartphones are, they're also evil.
Take a break.
Well, one of the things they showed on the news tonight was that kids are actually, it's changing the shape of their eyes, and kids are becoming nearsighted. Your eyes will grow, and children are having to wear contact lenses when they sleep to fix this. So no, we're not only talking about mental health, and I mean, at least the child could admit to understanding they were anxious. I mean, for 12 years old, I don't know that I would have known that that's what I was. But at the same time, like, it's crazy that a 12-year-old would be anxious about not having technology around them for a minute. But I see a lot of young people who be like, "Oh, I really want to, you know, I wouldn't want to be a Star Wars author at some point, or I want to, you know, be J.J. Abrams." Those people have to, when you create, when you do something on a scale that level, you literally do have to disconnect.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it takes extreme mental discipline. And I've told you guys, when I'm writing books, like, I may not know things that are going on because I have to sit down and for like 5 hours a day, I can't look at anything else except the material that I'm doing and write what I'm writing. So, you know, to achieve kind of these goals, especially if people want to have them, you have to learn how to disconnect to accomplish them. I mean, I know Sarah, like you can't listen, you can't do a podcast, edit it and read a bunch of things because you have to, right? You have to be focusing on the words that are coming in and maybe there's a or a something, or you know it's coming up and you need to catch it. There has to be mental discipline in order to produce things, and producing those things will make you feel good about yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, to go along with these challenges that Ashley put forth, I would encourage everyone to try to make these two things, because they're wonderful things, not just for one day, but to try to make them a habit in your life. Not necessarily just commenting on social media, but, you know, saying something nice to a stranger or somebody that you're passing by on the street, you know, that kind of thing. Try to make them habits, that you set your phone down during this period of time every day, or, you know, whatever the case may be. And then I kind of took things a little bit of a step further on my Instagram, just purely because I feel like we kind of talked about this a little bit, what we all try to compare ourselves to each other. And Ashley talked about this on the Her Universe Instagram, comparing our social medias and comparing our lives that we see on social media. And the reality of it is that everybody curates a life that they want people to believe that they live, when that's really not necessarily their entire life. It's just pieces of their life. So here's the challenge from Fangirls Going Rogue to you. And you can check, almost everybody on the show has done this. Post a picture on your social media feeds of something in your life that is not perfect. See Kai's empty, dirty fridge, my giant piles of laundry, and Sarah's crazy, incredibly messy office. Just because it is real life, and real life does happen, and we do not all live perfect lives. I guarantee you, we just don't. So I challenge you guys to do that and to share it with us. Let's do it, guys.
Yeah.
All right. So on wrapping that up, on mentioning books, and the reason that kind of brought into my head was I'm thumbing through Women of the Galaxy from Amy Ratcliffe, who we're going to interview next month on the show. Ooh. So for our character discussion, I thought all of us have been passionate about the women in the Star Wars galaxy, and we get this book that celebrates it. So in advance of that, let's all share one of our favorite characters from this book. And if you guys haven't picked it up, you can still, there's time. Amazon, all those wonderful places, go to a local bookstore. One of the ones that really got you excited when you looked at the book.
Okay, well, first, before I go into the person, I want to say that this book is a must-have book for every Star Wars fan. Just the way the artwork that's in here alone is worth having in your collection. Also, the way that things are written, you'll get a little bit of in-universe, a little bit of out-of-universe. It's really, really, really good. So the one that I'm going to pick, I have kind of like a list of three, but the one I'm going to pick, because I feel like this particular character actually means more to me, is R2KT, actually. She makes an appearance in this book, which I was surprised, but also very delighted. If you don't know who R2KT is, she is an R2 droid that was actually built for a little girl named Katie, who did pass away from a terminal illness. I think it was cancer. And her father was actually one of the founding members of the 501st. And the R2-D2 Builders Club actually made her a droid. And then she was canonized in the Clone Wars. She appeared in a few episodes of the Clone Wars. And then she also was in
The Force Awakens.
It was in The Force Awakens. Okay, mm-hmm. Yeah. So she was actually in The Force Awakens, the droid that has pink. And the reason she means a lot to me is I actually have all of her action figures. And this little girl, just like the story about her, just really, I don't know, it pulled at my heartstrings when I heard it. And so I love the fact that Amy got R2KT in here, and the artwork for her droid is just so amazing. It actually, I think they made the artwork. It's from a patch that was released in support of childhood cancer stuff. And so, but the artwork for R2KT is just awesome. Also, pink droid. Mm-hmm. Come on.
Kind of like purple lightsabers.
Yes.
Yes. Well, I'm going to pick my favorite character from this one, or the one that kind of struck me, and I'm going to turn it into a plug. I'm going to do it all. I'm just going to make this all work, because you should always celebrate yourself too, and be proud of it. Barissa Fee is in this book, and she's a really favorite character from a show that I fell in love with from Star Wars, which is the Clone Wars, and we're going to get to fall in love with it some more. It's like the Clone Wars is back. Timeless is saved maybe again. I'm like, Matt Lanter is having a year, let me tell you. But Bear Sophie, long story short, is I wrote a book in Star Wars. It is not out in English yet. I wrote it in English, though, but it is out in France and Spain. It's called Star Wars The Dark Side. And one of the struggles that is real is trying to get enough female characters into the weaving of this narrative of the dark side in Star Wars. And Barriss was a way I was able to bring a lot of things together in this book and make sure that we kind of remember that there are women who struggle with the dark side too. And so when I saw her in Amy's book, I was like, this is so exciting. So yeah, if you want to learn more, I do have copies of Star Wars The Dark Side, which the artwork is like amazing, and you can check it on my social media. But so I'm plugging Barriss in this one. Love the artwork.
Plugging Barriss and your book. And do we know when it's coming out in the US?
My understanding is that they're, you know, they're being a little slow on the stuff, picking stuff up over here, because maybe waiting until Celebration. So I don't know yet, but it is available in Spain and in France. And I did, there is a dedication in there that mentions Teresa, your name. You're my dark side girls. The book is dedicated to you. And it is also dedicated to my podcasting buddy, Sarah Woloski, for picking up slack when I was writing this book. So y'all's names are in there, but the words are French.
Is my name the same in French as it is in English?
It is. It's really weird to see like all these French words and then y'all's name. And then, like, Fangirls going rogue, and, you know, it's strange. So, but, yeah. All right, so, Kai, who's your favorite from this?
I picked Val, and when I got this book, I actually, like, I had to stop myself from tweeting the pictures, because I turned to her page, and I just started crying. And I'm in the minority when it comes to Val, because I feel like Val is a representation of everything I want in Star Wars. You know, I don't feel, most people think that she was like kind of redshirted and killed. But the thing that's so amazing about Val is not only is she a character that could have been a man, a woman, a dwarf, an alien, but that she had her own agency. And I don't feel like she died to save Beckett. I feel like she died on her own terms. And Thandie Newton brought that so powerfully in her acting. When you hear the story about who she based Val on, the walk, the natural hair, it'll just bring you to tears. And I feel like Val is exactly what I want as far when it comes to representation in Star Wars. And I'm so glad that they didn't kill the brown girl first in Solo. Spoilers. But, you know, I just thought it meant a lot to me that, you know, his whole crew died, but she didn't die first. So, you know, I don't know how to explain that as someone, as a person of color, and you try to give these studios and these films a chance, and you're like, oh man, they killed the black person first again. Mm. And it just meant, and as much as I loved Rigoli, I was like, yeah, they killed someone first besides the brown person, you know, and
well,
the
whole Kai, it's not a horror movie. It happens in
general sci-fi and horror, which are my two great loves growing up. The same thing, like the brown person usually gets it first, you know. And I was just sitting there, and I was just like, and when it kind of starts to open up, thinking that you're starting to see, like, okay, his whole crew is going to die. That this is the purpose of the story. I just love how she lived by the sword and she died by the sword, and she made her choice. And that's the kind of representation I want. I don't want tokenism. I don't want let's just put a brown girl in. I want a living, breathing character that makes choices and has repercussions to those choices.
I think we have to give a lot of the credit to the way Thandi Newton played the character.
Yes. It all goes to her, kind of.
Definitely. All right. Well, I'm going to bring it all around, and I'm going to say that Ahsoka Tano really caught my eye in this book and in The Clone Wars and when she came out. And honestly, Ahsoka is really the reason this podcast exists, because of Ashley Eckstein voicing her and her starting her universe and all of us coming together because of that. So I'm just amazed at how Ahsoka is portrayed in this book, Women of Star Wars. And she has no less than 4 beautiful illustrations of all her different phases of life, like from the 14-year-old to the not quite Jedi to the fulcrum. I think she's beautiful. And even fighting Darth Vader at the very end. So I think it's amazing. And the write-up that Amy Ratcliffe gave is very beautiful. And I love the fact that she wrote it up so nicely through all the different versions of Ahsoka, because, you know, she's been represented in both TV series, 2 TV series, and a novel. She really bridged those gaps. So, and hopefully we'll see more of Ahsoka. As Amy Ratcliffe writes at the end, her journey continues. And our journey continues, you guys, through 2019.
Yay. Yes. It does.
And one more thing about the book,
Star Wars.
I really suggest everyone take the time to go in the back and look up these artists, because a lot of them are on social media profiles. And Amy, like me, goes to a lot of conventions, and you can actually meet. One of my new fan goals is to kind of take this book to conventions and get the artist to sign it, because a lot of these artists are working artists. They go to Artist Alley at cons all across the world. And she really put a lot of thought into cultivating the artists for this book. And so take the time to go and look them up. I guarantee pretty much, if not all, half of them are on social media. And, you know, support their art, take your book, and make it a kind of fan goal.
Yeah, and people who don't know, there's notebooks with this art.
Yes,
that you can also get.
Have them.
And they are coming out with postcards, which Kay posted on social media today, that there's 100 postcard set.
Oh my God. Let me explain the oh my God. Okay. So we were reviewing this book for Star Wars Bookworms, and I was talking about how a lot of this art is actually exclusive to this book. It's not art we've seen other places or anything like that got repurposed and used. And so I was like, oh, I need a second one so that I can cut out the pictures.
Now you don't have to.
I know, because I was going to make a collage with like Mod Podge. Oh, and now awesome. I don't have to. So now I can just take all of the postcards and I can collage them. And I don't have to cut up a book and feel the pain when I do that. Because that literally physically pains me to have to cut a book apart, but I was going to do it.
So where can we find these, the notebooks and these the postcards?
The notebooks were up for pre-order at Chronicle Books.
Oh, nice. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, they're $12.95 for 3. You get, there's an Ahsoka Tano one, a Leia, and a Rey. And one of the cool things about them, I have them right in my hand, is they are lined. And at the bottom of some of the pages, not all the pages, but it has quotes from the characters. And in like the case of Ahsoka's, there's some dialogue back and forth between Anakin and Ahsoka. Like Anakin will be on one page and Ahsoka will be on the other. So that's kind of cool to see those little tidbits of dialogue from the films kind of spread through your little notebook.
No, I just need 2 sets, because I'm gonna want one perfect set to never
write in.
Yeah, so I'm kind of on Prime right now ordering 2. Thanks, nice. Teresa.
Oh, you're welcome. All right, guys. Well, that brings us to the end of this episode. It was an incredible conversation, guys. Thank you so much for being here. And Kai, thank you for being here with us to have this conversation. Where can people find you on social media, Kai, if they want to talk to you or learn a little bit more about what you do?
I'm at Yogi Kai. I'm on Twitter a lot. Twitter, and if you answer all the questions correctly, I'm always lurking in the Fangirls Going Rogue and Skywalking Through Neverland Facebook groups. So join us, be good, and answer the questions.
We appreciate that plug.
Yeah, thank you.
So many
thank
people
you.
Who don't answer the questions.
I have to say, I believe in like attracting like, and I have never been a part of a group that I don't know what it is, if it's something we do energetically, but we don't have any jerks in our group. And we've had some, both the fangirl and the skywalking, and I call them mine because that's how you feel. There's such an ownership, even though they're not mine and I don't moderate, but there is just something about the energy and what the groups exist for. We have really tough, you know, tough discussions sometimes, and Teresa will come in or Richard or Sarah will come in and say, you know, we're really loving this positive, you know, exchange of ideas. Let's keep it up. So, you know, test and see if you can become one of us, because it's a great place to be. And I'm on Facebook more because of the two groups.
I'm on Facebook more because I don't, like, can't see everybody's everything because of Facebook algorithms. Oh, man. But you can find us at fangirlsgoingrogue.com. You can also find us on Instagram and Twitter at FGGoingRogue. Sarah, I'm sorry. I don't know where that came from. I stole your line. You can find Trisha at Fangirl Cantina. I am at Ice Cold Penguin. Sarah is at Jedi Tink. And Sandra is at Geek Chic 9.
Yeah, and Sandra's a big part of making sure that huge group is important and running the conversation. So we always want to acknowledge her. You can email us at contact@fangirlsgoingrogue.com. Facebook, just type Fangirls Going Rogue. That's we have a public page, and then we have the private page. And then Tumblr is fangirlsgoingrogue.tumblr.com.
And you can also leave us a voicemail if this conversation really jarred something in you that you'd love to share. Please share it with us. We are 331-21-EWOCS. And once again, our Facebook group, which Kai was so gratefully plugging for us.
Please go to Apple Podcasts and leave a positive 5-star review. We need your reviews so more people can find us.
So until next time, make sure to do those 3 things that we told you to do, and da 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 da, yub
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 yub. Yub.
Luna, Harry, I am now recording. Behave. Harry, get out from behind the bed. Stop.
He's going to try to pounce somebody. Trisha, you ready?
I'm ready.
Kai.
I'm here ready.
No, sir. He's opening doors, guys. I wish you could. I could videotape this.
Is that you?
What is that? That's not me.
Is that Kai?
No, I'm sitting really still so I don't make noise.
Trisha? It's a ghost.
Stop. I'm freaking out.
I don't know how this sounds.
Oh, wait. Oh, okay, speak some more.
How does that sound?
That sounds
way
good.
Better.
All right.
What were you just doing?
I was switching mics.
Oh, because I was like, ghost. I was like, what is that? And nobody was answering. We were like, is it a ghost?
Yes. Which comes out on October 8th. So it's a birthday movie.
What?
I mean, I'm sorry.
October 8th?
Hold on. Let me try that again.
What are you?
Hey, go back to March 8th.
What?
Yes. I totally wrote that wrong. Okay, hold on.
Yeah,
let me try.
That's been there for a while, and I was like, I don't know what you're thinking, but
that's why I read it wrong. Okay.
And please go to Apple Pie
Apple Podcast.
Outtake.
Yeah.
Okay. Please go.
Shh.
Please go to Apple Pod.
Oh, God.
Practically perfect in every way.
So until next time, make sure to do those three things that we told you to do and always remember.
What? Never. What are you talking about, Sarah? Sarah, oh, what are you recording right now?
I do this like four times.
Where's your song?
Yub, yub.
Yub, yub.
And until next time, da 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 da. Yub.
Yub.
Yub. Train wreck.
Wow. You know, every time you say dun 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 dun, I feel like you're going to say, this was a story.
Yes.
Lady.
Really?
It sounds like the Brady Bunch theme song.
It does. And Teresa's so young. How does that get in your head?
Nick at Night, but I have the whole entire series of the Brady Bunch on DVD.
Wow. Oh my gosh.
Okay. I also have every episode of I Love Lucy. So what? What then?
Yeah. Okay, we have to talk about that Hawaiian Tiki Idol episode at one point.
Yeah.
That's like the highlight of my life.
Here's the thing. The Brady Bunch as a whole for the show, like in its big box set, it came in a box that was covered in shag carpet.
Oh.
It's green shag carpet.
Oh my gosh.